and our second seminar session looking at the aviation industry. As I mentioned to those of you who were here yesterday, it's been another momentous year in aviation. We've seen all sorts of challenges, changes and opportunities, and of course the Gulf carriers have been very much part of that, and of course Emirates as their home carrier has been in the news for all sorts of reasons, particularly recently, ranging from aircraft orders and a certain complaint coming out of the USA from a number of American carriers about business practices and allegations of subsidies. So a lot of things to keep the president of the airline, Sir Tim Clark, busy. So we're very lucky to have him here today. So Sir Tim, welcome to the stage.
Thank you.
And congratulations on your knighthood as well. I think last time I
yes,
saw you,
you thank you.
You've not been knighted, so thank congratulations.
You.
We have 1 hour of Sir Tim's precious time, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions. When that time comes, put your hand up, we'll get a mic to you, and if you could introduce yourself as well when you ask the question. But meanwhile, I'll take my seat and let's kick off. So Tim, I said it had been a momentous year. Of course, your financial results are coming out this Thursday, so we won't preempt that in obviously in detail, but just tell us a little bit about the last year. What have been the highs and the lows for Emirates?
Well, it's been a difficult year. Geopolitically, we know we've had to shut down 5 stations during the course of the year. And the volatility has made trading in other parts of the world. We've had the strengthening dollar, which means a lot of our currencies that we generate income in have also gone south a little bit. But nevertheless, it's probably the second most profitable year in our history, I will say that. We were helped by the fuel coming off in the second part of the year. We didn't hedge at all, so we were able to gain the advantages of a falling fuel price. But nevertheless, we increased our income, we increased our production, we took on a lot more fleet, we retired many of the old aircraft, and that process is in transition at the moment. But taken together, despite the difficulties of, for instance, we had to shut one of the runways at Dubai for 90 days last summer and put 22 aircraft on the ground, etc. So with all of that and with the volatility of the market, I'm particularly pleased that the team has managed to get the group to where it will be revealed on Thursday.
Well, we look forward to hearing that in more detail, Tim. I mean, you mentioned there about the grounding you had to do. I remember this time last year I interviewed Paul Griffiths just as that was about to come into effect. It seemed to go to plan, but it's a pretty big hit for any airline to have 20 plus aircraft on the ground. But I also listened to your interview on the flight coming over, and I think you were saying there that despite that, you'd actually grown activity significantly in that period and managed to minimize the number of aircraft compared to what you thought.
I think that the notion that the alternative was to close the airport, those runways, from midnight till 6 o'clock in the morning for upwards of a year, 18 months, and of course that wasn't going to work. So we delayed the closure of the northern runway to a window of time that we knew we would be able to pre-plan and work. So that's exactly what we did. Result of that was that we were able to channel the business that was hitherto going on those grounded aircraft onto the remaining fleet. So with the amount of pre-planning we did, with the commercial people doing what they did, we were able to actually do a lot better than we thought we would do. But nevertheless, when you do ground 20, 22 aircraft, and you've got crew and overhead and everything else to deal with, it is a little bit of an issue, but 10% of our issue is.
And of course, given that you operate a hub model, it wasn't worth flying any aircraft or using any aircraft out of DWC.
No, that wasn't on the table at all for us. So that we managed.
Okay. What about geographically? How would you say the world differed in the last year in terms of which markets were more robust and which perhaps proved more challenging?
I guess, surprisingly, Europe came on stronger than we thought it would, despite the euro being 20% down on what it was at the beginning of our last financial year. Markets like Greece and Spain and Portugal and Italy, despite the difficulties they were having in the eurozone, actually were very strong for us, particularly Greece, which is an interesting one with what's going on at the moment. So we have.
Why do you think that was? Because I think in short haul, I've heard Ryanair saying the same thing. They're seeing enormous activity in and out of Greece.
Yes, I think there's this sort of parallel economy arguments going on. So certainly our flights in all three classes were pretty full, including the first class cabins. We increased our production into Italy, put the 380 into Milan, increased production in Milan, extended the Malpensa to New York, and on the 1st of June, we put the 380 on Malpensa, New York. We have increased our production into Spain, 380 going into Madrid, 380 already in Barcelona, probably the second Lisbon coming up later on in the year, and such. So Europe has been very strong for us. Asia has been a bit of a dogfight. A lot of capacity in the market there. We get kind of mixed up in the conflict between the low cost and the indigenous carriers there, the legacy carriers, but we're dealing with that. And by and large, the production growth and the income growth matched. So if we went up 10 or 11%, we matched that with our income. So actually, with some areas going south, some of our African countries were a little bit weaker than we thought they would be. We've got issues with Ebola, and the perception in Asia was that Ebola was an African continent issue. Right. And it affected all our routes, including Southern Africa. Mm-hmm. So that all these things had to be dealt with, but you know, we're good at adjusting our production, turning the taps on and off, whatever. Whatever the global issues may be and how the global economy reacts to all those kind of things. So, not a bad year.
I mean, I wanted to ask you that question about, as you say, turning the taps on and off and moving aircraft around in two respects, because I'm very conscious, you know, being Europe-based, I look at the low-cost airlines and Ryanair and EasyJet in particular are very adept at moving these expensive assets around, the aircraft and the crews, they'll move them around the map of Europe, according to demand and opportunity. Now, long haul has more challenges, whether it's maybe regulatory or logistics of crews and so on, but you've described that you do it. How challenging is it? And also the size you've got to as an airline now. I wrote down in my notes the word nimbleness. Can you keep this nimbleness to move planes, or does it really take an age to move a plane out of a market or to an opportunity?
The essence of our management style, and I'm particularly focused on this, is that the company, despite its scale, despite its size today, does not fall into a group of compartments and silos. The nimbleness of our ability to move our assets around is a function largely of the way the management is organized. If the management is organized so that there is a can-do attitude, we can move 380s on one route and put them on another. We can do all sorts of things. Other carriers that are more compartmentalized, more siloized in their structures and in their DNA, they find it difficult to do these things. But with us, if the Russian ruble went south, as we knew it did, we pulled the 380s off Moscow and put them somewhere else quite quickly and quite adeptly on markets that we knew would take the 380s and were actually demanding the 380s well before we actually made the move. So we just accelerated some of our plans. And nimbleness in our business, given the way the global economy, the geopolitics of the global economy is moving in many, many mysterious ways. If you're trading on the global stage as we do, we have to adapt to whatever happens. And that's the nature of the business. If you are structured in such a format that you do not have that capability of doing that, then you will surely fail.
And do you have a kind of a rolling reserve list, you know, like scenarios? If this happens, we could do A, B, or C,
yes.
Or you do actually do that?
Yes. We know where we need capacity, what type of aircraft. So, I mean, there's no point saying we're going to put a 380 into an airport that can't take the 380 because it's not compliant. But yes, we know exactly what. For every airport, there are about another 100 cities on the list, towns and cities that we want to go to, what we can do and when.
Now, what one new route you announced, which seemed out of, I don't know, out of kilter for Emirates to me, was Orlando. I mean, obviously, we'll talk about, as we go through, about the USA, but again, coming from the UK, I think of that as, you know, a bucket and spade leisure destination. UK and Europe, it's very popular, and it doesn't seem to have a normal business dynamics that you would look for, multiple trade flows and cargo and so on. Or is it simply the same here, that people out of Dubai connecting are going to that part of the USA for leisure reasons, and you saw an opportunity?
A large part of the demand segmentation is, of course, leisure, is, of course, the cruise business in Fort Lauderdale. But notwithstanding that, you have quite a large JetBlue hub in Orlando. And the fee that JetBlue will give us, as they do in Boston and New York, will allow us to access many other points in the southern part of the states over Orlando. So if you want to go to Miami, if you want to go to smaller cities and towns in that part of the world, JetBlue will be there for you. But I will make no secret of the fact that it is a hugely popular leisure destination, not just for Europe, but when you open Orlando, in the kind of connectivity that we will do over the Dubai hub, to the West Asian markets, India, Pakistan, Iran, Bangladesh, etc. And those middle class segments are growing all the time. They will jump on our plane and go to Orlando rather than going up to the European hubs and then going south again. So it'll be a quick, easy way of getting there and a very affordable way of getting there. So hopefully it'll work.
Well, of course, I'm going to ask you more questions about network and so on as we come on. But let's kind of get onto the elephant in the room at this point and just talk a bit about the complaint. We've seen this formal complaint, a white paper from the US carriers directed to the governments, particularly of the UAE and Qatar. They stressed not directed to the airlines, but talking about the way the airlines here operates, Emirates, Qatar, and Etihad, and make allegations running to pages and pages on subsidy, in their eyes, unfairness of business practices, damaging competition that on their line of reasoning is not equitable. Has this kind of come out of the blue? I mean, there's always been people looking at Emirates and the other carriers over time, but to actually come out with a document which they seemingly have worked on for 2 years, was that a sudden thing from your point of view?
I guess we were aware of something going on over there. Not as perhaps focused and as orchestrated as the Europeans have been over the last 20 years. And using your choice of words, the line of reasoning of the big three, if you can call it that, which drove the compilation of a 55-page dossier which made multiple allegations about what we do as Emirates, what Qatar Airways does, what Etihad does, and what the governments do, etc. Now, as I think I've said on two occasions, I use the words flim-flam and tosh, because right. In my view, that's exactly what it is. Having read this report and realizing that you could drive a bulldozer through just about everything they wrote about us, we will respond in a very robust manner. That report, our response to that is under compilation at the moment. They have, admittedly, on their own admission, taken 2 years. And they used the expression, their gumshoes, went around the world digging out all sorts of things about us. So my response to the US government is one that you must allow us to respond. Anybody can make an allegation about anybody or anything. If they are as serious as they are, the US government must give the other side, the counterparties, the response time. Secondly, that we require time to do it if it took them 2 years, and we have a response to make which has to be robust and in the depth that we are going to have to do it, I need more time. So we will do that, and we will deal a sledgehammer to that report as far as Emirates in Dubai is concerned. So watch the space, it's coming.
Okay. Now, you said at Emirates in Dubai, they've directed this at, you know, the Qatar and the UAE and involving the three airlines. I guess you can't speak for the three airlines, even though Emirates is the biggest in the family and the eldest, if you like. Is everybody going to have to fend for themselves on this? We're speaking to Akbar Abakar tomorrow, for example. Is it going to be a three-way answer?
I think the three carriers involved in this will be making their own submissions. What that's going to contain, what they contain, is up to them. Mm-hmm. I know what ours will do, and I suspect there will be a lot of similarities. Now, the important thing about all of this is that the United States in the 90s was moving away from a predeterminist era political model, which was Bermuda 1 and Bermuda 2, Bermuda 3, Bermuda Triangle, call it what you like, by the end of the 90s, they had decided that this was not serving the United States in its political and economic aspirations as it should have done, as it was doing. So they morphed this whole aeropolitical process into what is now known as the open skies situation. And it was that model, because it came from the United States, and it was fairly prescriptive from the United States, in other words, they signed up 112 or 114 agreements under this open skies model. And the open skies documentation, this model stripped out all restrictions that had hitherto been in the instruments that drove aeropolitics. And it dealt from the macro to the micro, and it simplified the whole process. At the time that they were doing that, of the 112 countries that they actually embarked on, many of those had state-owned airlines. The Americans knew this when they entered into it. Many of those had state-controlled or funded organizations in the aviation sector. The Americans knew that. I can go on. So when it was signed, the ability for the United States to come back at those countries or those entities that were state-owned, continue to be state-owned, etc., was extremely difficult. They crafted the document. The countries that signed up did not. And in the 99 bilateral in Abu Dhabi that I sat with the United States negotiating team, I questioned them on this to make absolutely sure that what they were saying to the United Arabs delegation was as simple and as pure as it had been crafted and the document I was looking at. And they assured me that's what it was, which was fantastic because as far as Emirates was concerned, this is exactly the kind of aeropolitical environment that we like to operate in. Mm-hmm. At the time, there were two nominated carriers for the United Arab Emirates. One was Gulf Air. Gulf Air was state-owned, state-controlled, and losing money. Yet the Americans made no provision for dealing with that particular nominated carrier. So in the end, the instrument that determines the movement of aircraft and airlines between multiple points in the USA and the United Arab Emirates is driven by their own document. And that's exactly what we are doing and will continue to do so. The question of subsidy, as far as Emirates is concerned, is a non-starter. We have never been subsidized. We have never received from the government of Dubai any kind of specialist or special treatment. We have been conscious of the fact that we have to grow. We have grown this business from when I first came in 1985 from nothing to 35, 40 aircraft today, and have created an airline that is probably one of the largest, most successful in aviation, civil aviation history. And we have done that without state intervention, without state funding. We have no shareholder funding at all. So, I mean, if we were a listed company, I suppose on many occasions we would have gone for rights issues to try and raise cash. We've had to do this from generating cash flow, generating our ability, creating debt from the international markets, etc., grown our business, taken on a balance sheet now which is in the tune of $25-30 billion from $10 million that the government gave us, and maintained our profitability and our cash build. So we have about, I don't know, 18 billion dirhams on the cash in the cash book at the moment. When somebody tells us that we were subsidized in that process, that we were subsidized in that timeline, and seeks to identify where we were subsidized, you're talking to the wrong people. Because we know that our financial statements, as verified and audited by PricewaterhouseCoopers, are absolutely spot on. The veracity of what we say in those documents 100%. If we didn't, PwC wouldn't stand up and sign on that. So for me, I sleep relatively easy in my bed with regard to the rebuttal of subsidy.
Well, and they've even quoted, you say you sleep soundly, they've even quoted you in the document saying, well, the day somebody proves subsidies of Emirates, I'll resign the next day. They've been
and I think they've been labouring that. And I often say, well, if that's the case, and if you can prove the subsidy, I'm dying to know where it is, because I'd love to know how we have received, where we've received this money. Show me where we've got it. But equally, if you are wrong, and we show you to be wrong, and we show these falsehoods are surely falsehoods, tosh, flim flam, will you resign? What will you do when this rebuttal comes back at you and shows the stakeholders, the political entities that you've managed to orchestrate to come behind you, that they are fundamentally wrong as far as we're concerned? What will you do? Will you go somewhere else to try and sort it out? But in the end, we'll deal with it.
How long do you think it's going to take, Tim? Because I think the document says, or from what I've read, pursuant to this document is a 60-day return period. But you say you're not under any guillotine, that you've got to get back in 2 months what has taken 2 years to prepare.
We will do it in our own time. We will make sure that it covers off everything that we need to cover off, and when we're ready, we will present that to the government. There is nothing in the, going back to the air services agreement, that requires us to do. There is no prescription as about timeline to anything else. We will do what we must do, and I hope that the US government will wait until we're ready.
I mean, this is a subsidy argument, and I'm no lawyer, but you know my background coming from network planning. So when I've read the document and looked at some of the aspects of things that are quoted there, it raised questions with me, and I want to try to play the neutral path, but I've looked at the Emirates model many times over the years. And first of all, I want to ask you, how much do you and the American carriers overlap? Because this is one of the claims, you're eating their lunch, as it were,
that is part of our response, of course. If you look at, take American Airlines, American Airlines does not serve this region at all, full stop. They do not serve the Middle East, North Africa, West Asia, Africa, they don't appear. They do 5 or 6 points in Asia, many points in Europe, obviously domestic US and South America. So for American Airlines to say that we're eating their lunch, from the multiple points that there is no overlap, from the multiple points that we bring tens of millions of passengers into the United States, surprising. If you look at the activities of Delta and United, they have one flight a day from Atlanta into Dubai, that's Delta, and one flight a day from Washington for United. That's it. They don't go anywhere else. They are conspicuous by their absence. So I'm really interested to see how it is that from a competitive point of view, when we're serving multiple points in the Indian Ocean, Africa, and all the places that you know we serve, that they can claim that we are doing them damage. They often cite that their joint venture partners are affected by market share. Hey ho, guys, market share is not a right. Market share is earned. And if the quality of our business and our product and the value proposition is a better one, and we can connect people from all the points that they don't serve, that their joint ventures partners do in a very roundabout manner, then why would you deprive the passengers, the consumer base, the right to do that? Why would you force them over hubs in other places at higher prices, convoluted routings to get where we can do in one stop? So but even that, we're not here to argue the toss with regard to their joint venture partners. The joint venture partners are not part of this. If they are European carriers, that is that's their bailiwick. That's where they come from. That's what they do. If they choose to form marketing alliances, that's up to them. But it does not preclude somebody like us doing the kind of business we're doing at the moment.
But that point you mentioned about market share, they make two examples in their reporting. One of the US-India market, where they say the Gulf carriers have cost us 5 percentage points of market share. But again, thinking of my history in network planning, market share is not the absolute size you're talking about. So I know the UK-India market has grown almost exponentially in recent years. So they claim also, well, we haven't seen any meaningful stimulation, but do you refute that, Sir Tim? I mean, because I would have guessed it would be similar to the UK. The market would have grown since you put capacity in.
John, all I can say to that is that they really need to do a little bit more analysis. Too much of this report that they have written skims the surface. It is cosmetic. It's qualitative. It's based on innuendo and all sorts of things. If they actually did their sums, if they actually were in the markets. Remember, we did not start flying to the United States until 2004. Between 1985 and 2004, Emirates was not in the United States. Was that to suggest that there were no Indians or Bangladeshis or Iranians or Sri Lankans traveling to the US or Canada? I think probably not. There were lots going. They chose not to be there. They had the aeropolitical rights to do that. From 1999, they could go whatever, to any point they could, they were able to do from Abu Dhabi and Dubai with full fifth freedoms. They didn't do that. So for them to say that there was, we were taking their market and that this was compromising their ability to trade, that is absolute nonsense. And we will show that to be the case.
What about that? I mean, they also put the argument that you're growing at rates way in excess of GDP, depending on whichever economy. But I know certainly looking at the low-cost model, short-haul, that's also been the case with airlines like, say, Ryanair in Europe. But the market, again, has grown. Is that a valid complaint, especially where we maybe have troubled economic times in some parts of the world?
No, I don't think that's a valid complaint at all. The link to GDP and demand for air travel is a positive one, and it is a guide in sort of the macroeconomics of the way we go about our business. The microeconomics is completely different. We talked about Greece, we talked about Portugal, mm-hmm. we talked about Spain earlier. The essence of the Emirates model is one of connectivity to first, second and third level cities. And so long as we do that, and so long as we identify demand irrespective of GDP in one country being faster or slower than the country that we're selecting our business from, then we will take that business. So, the fact is that if the American GDP is faltering or slowing, does that mean to say we have to slow our access to Dar es Salaam, Entebbe, Addis Ababa, Harare, Lusaka? All these points, these Africans of all segmentation are going to the US on our services. Why? Because there are no other ways of doing it. And if they are, they're extremely expensive and very convoluted. Visa requirements in Dubai, airside, once you transit Dubai, are non-existent. If you are many of the nationalities that I mentioned, you travel via a European hub, you're required to have a visa just to transit. It is a real inhibitor. So what we look for is obviously the true nature of the demand of the city pairs that we're serving. Our connectivity, the essence of our business model is one of connectivity, a quality product, fast connections to multiple points that are not well served at this point in time. And what we find, even when GDP is going south, our markets grow. So that's the microeconomics of the effect of our business model on those lesser size cities.
I don't want to consume the whole session on this, so just two more questions for you on this, Tim. Again, Milan they use as an example, because that was something where Emirates stepped out of its normal operation, everything in and out of Dubai, the aircraft obviously starts in Dubai, but it does a point-to-point Milan-New York, and you've had some challenges there. They cite there they've lost even more market share, but has that market grown? And they accuse you of being opportunistic as an airline, going into markets like this and putting threats that you may do more. Are you just being opportunistic and not devil may care about
that? I will make no secret of the fact that we are opportunistic. If we didn't, we wouldn't be where we are today. But opportunistic does not mean that we go after other carriers to try and take them down. It's simply looking at the opportunities and taking them because we can and because we are nimble enough to do so at the time that we want to do it. In the case of Milan, New York, it was an interesting one because actually, although it was in the dim, distant part of the screen on our radar, it wasn't there. It was only because the Italian government came to us and said, please operate. Why did they say that? Because Alitalia had decided to move away from its twin hub policy and concentrate on Rome. Malpensa had just been built by the Italians, or the investors in that, and it was left high and dry. So it was the Prime Minister at the time who approached my boss, His Highness Sheikh Ahmed, and said, would you help out? And Sheikh Ahmed said, sure, we'll look at it. So we started flying there. What these carriers seem to miss is that Malpensa, New York, is not the problem. Linate the smaller airport, which is very close to the center of Milan, takes huge amounts of business over multiple European points into multiple hubs in the US. And they, prior to our arriving, they chose not to fly on a 757 of United or a 767-200 of Delta, built, I think, in 1988. They chose to fly on the European carriers out of Linate with the stop in the European hubs, whether it be Frankfurt, Paris, or London, and go that way. So rather than deal with that issue, they took us on and said, we are taking business away from them. That's patently wrong. And again, we will have to evidence that. We will show it.
Okay. Last thing on this topic, Tim. We're seeing, you know, fissures developing in the industry on this issue, quite dramatic steps in Europe with the AEA, the Association of European Airlines, the IAG members, of course, British Airways and Iberia left, a number of other carriers with some Gulf links to Etihad, Air Berlin has left, Alitalia, I believe, has left. Do you think this is going to have wider ramifications than the issue itself in terms of the structure of the industry and airlines' ability to either work with each other or compete with each other and the future shape?
I think a couple of years ago, or 3 years ago, at the IATA annual general meeting in Beijing, when asked, I think by Richard Quest, in your kind of role at the moment, he sort of threw the question open. He asked me specifically in the audience what I thought about what was happening to the industry. And I said, what you're seeing is the beginning of the fracturing of the world order of aviation internationally that has driven, dominated from the 80s, 90s, and the early part of 2000 to about 2008. There is a sea change, sorry about that choice of word, air change, sea change, whatever, going on at the moment. And what you're seeing now is the beginning of the dismembering of the aviation world order as we know. That is, of course, looking at alliances, the way they're structured. There is a new breed of airline coming through, not just us or Qatar or Emirates. There's a new breed of low-cost long-haul. Look at Norwegian, look at Tony Fernandez. Look at the way IAG moved out of AEA
and
joined the low-cost association. So you see an alignment between what is going on the low-cost, where there are similarities, but not essentially the same, between those carriers that are very market-focused, cost-focused, segmentation-focused, working closer with the low-cost fraternity, because after all, this is the segment of our business which is growing at speed. On top of that, you've got the likes of Emirates, Etihad, and Qatar, and now you have Turkish Airlines, which has unashamedly, we're very pleased to say, taken our model and said, we can do this. The government of Turkey is about to, well, they say they're going to finish the largest European hub.
In 3 years or so.
In 3 years. This is a miracle, but good for them. However, when it is finished, it'll be a serious challenge to the way things go over the alliance hubs. Now, the likes of IAG, which, don't forget, is an anchor tenant in Europe of one world, must be asking itself, how are they going to align, and how are they going to align the business in the 21st century with what the demand is? We have seen segments come to market we would have never contemplated 10 years ago. It's bubbling, it's moving. And they really don't want to be involved in alliances. They don't necessarily want to travel over strange routings. They want a good value proposition, they want to be looked after, the way information technology is moving, the mobility platforms, our ability to communicate with individuals, talk to them, reach them, communicate with them, etc. That is have more value in terms of the deal I can do for you with your mobile platforms, whatever they may be, than getting suckered into an alliance because I've got to get miles or I get this, etc., etc. What we're finding, there is a shift in the consumer-based thinking with regard to how the 21st century is going to shape up in the next 10 or 15 years. And this is why I see the beginnings of not a disintegration, a realignment of the way businesses are run. There will be those that cling to the vestiges and the security of alliances. There will be those that break away. And those are what I call the alignment carriers, those that understand that the old way is the old way. There is a new way, and you have to follow that if you're going to survive.
Well, I think it's very interesting in Europe. I mean, as I think, was it Donald Rumsfeld who called it old Europe or old France or something in the past? We have IAG led by Willie Walsh, who has been vehemently lavish with his praise with all the Gulf carriers. Of course, now has a shareholding from Qatar Airways in IAG. There are some voices that I've seen in the last few weeks saying, well, IAG would be like this, wouldn't they? They've got Fortress Heathrow. Nobody can get in. But equally, he's turned around other airlines like Iberia that others would have thought would be hopeless, no chance. They announced profit figures last week in the first quarter. They'd normally lose money. But actually, they are in Fortress Heathrow. But you're there five times a day. I think Etihad 3 and Qatar 5. They've already got more competition in a confined space than, say, Air France at Paris or Lufthansa in Frankfurt.
Absolutely. Just on the point about Iberia, it is an incredible feat for Willie and that team to have turned around Iberia from what it was to a profitable organisation. And hats off to him for getting that done, because frankly, when he did it, I had my doubts. But he really did a good job. And yes, Willie is a product of the new thinking. He is somebody who realized that the way it was is not the way it's going to be in the future. And we must move towards that. We must grasp it. We must get on with it. We must engage with it. And I think some of the statements that he has made with regard to, we talked about the American issue earlier, he has been very vocal about that. He has written to the CEOs of the big three directly and said, IAG does not agree with any of this. We do not support you. And if you think that we are going to remain quiet about this, we will not. And he has said that quite publicly. So for someone like that, remember, One World is probably of all the alliances, the more, let's say, the one that is more loosely structured. Mm-hmm. It isn't demanding of its members to the extent that Star and SkyTeam are. But for him to stand up and say that, for me, was certainly a leader in the industry saying, it's got to change, it is going to change, and we're going to facilitate that change. So that's what I mean, whereas you start seeing the fracturing of the business.
Well, it does look to me, I mean, it's slightly humorously, like there is, as you say, a new breed of management. But I don't know if it's something in the Irish blood. I mean, Willie's Irish, we have Michael O'Leary, who has really made a revolutionary changes in operation in Europe, but with impacts around the world with the Ryanair low-cost model. And of course, there's Alan Joyce in Qantas. So I think the last time we sat here, we had Alan Joyce with us 2 years ago. He's a leading airline that has thrown its lot in with a Gulf carrier, as IAG has done with Qatar. They've got the partnership, not a financial one, but a very close business partnership. How is that going now, 2 years on, with Qantas?
Well, I like to think that when Qantas turned the corner and declared quite good profits very recently,
yeah,
that we had something to do with that. And that the ability of Emirates to handle its international operation, in partnership, of course, with them, with their two flights a day over Dubai, to the west of the oceanic continent, allow them to concentrate on domestic, on Asian, on Trans-Pacific and US feed. So they've got the Dallas operation going in with the 380 and all these other things. So I think part of that, I'd like to think, and judging by the metrics that we look at, it's doing the job that we both wanted it to do when we met all those years ago. So I think he's quite a happy...
Do you think there are going to be other airlines that will reappraise? I mean, IAG has done it. They'd already done it unofficially with Qatar coming to One World. Qantas has done it with you. In a strange way, it seems to me, even Air France is doing some activity with Etihad, but at the same time leveling complaints. Do you think others may think, well, there is a different approach? It's not to criticize, it's to join in with the New World Order.
I think there have been, I remember Robert Milton, who ran Air Canada and the ACE group that controlled Air Canada. He stated that this was the new way. This was in 2002, I think. Mm-hmm. And that Air Canada needed to move its position from its current business model to one of international engagement. Now, it actually didn't work. They are where they are at the moment. You have to ask, why did Etihad 3 days ago announce that it was expanding its co-chair with American Airlines, one of the big three, to an additional seven cities in the United States. I don't get this, you know? Why did, I think, Akbar and others do something in Europe? Why did Etihad do more with Air France over another SkyTeam player in Europe? It kind of doesn't stack up. You can have your cake, but you can't eat it as well, guys. You either like us or you don't like us, but don't sort of start increasing your business with us at the same time as saying, we don't want you here at all.
I mean, Lufthansa is still kind of, if you like, holding out, putting up the barricades, you could say, from your point of view. I remember you telling me in a previous interview that you were open to talking with Lufthansa in the past, and maybe along the same lines as Qantas, but now they're setting up the long-haul Euro wings from the autumn with their Sun Express partner and using A330s to do leisure-type long-haul, one of which is going to be Dubai from Cologne. Do you think they've got a chance? Is that the right answer for them, do you think, to...
Well, I don't know. You need
don't
to ask.
Don't want to be a partner. We'll do
you,
this instead.
You need to ask them. They are, and I think quite openly, concerned about their cost base, and rightly so. If you operate 13 different aircraft types, it's likely that you're going to have a high cost base. I think the solution to what they see as a problem, being cost driven, is to take on a long haul, low cost operation. So hey ho, Lufthansa is already moving in the direction that I said other carriers would do a few minutes ago. They're shifting their business model. So if they want to sell 99 euros from Cologne to Dubai, great, that's excellent. Our hotels will be filled, hopefully with lots of Germans who will empty their pockets. And I'm quite sure that Sheikh Ahmed, our boss, would be more than happy to fit them in as best we can. It doesn't faze us. All I would say is good luck to you. I hope it works for you. If you want to do more, don't worry about us. We may not be able to fit you in Dubai. You may have to go to DWC. But good luck. I mean, Dubai is open for business. It's an open skies regime. Anybody's welcome. If you're going to add value to what goes on in this city, nobody's going to get in your way. So if that's what they think is going to make them money, good luck to them.
And talking of DWC, what is the prognosis there for you moving in lock, stock and barrel? Is it still going to be likely early 2020s?
I think the scale of what we are trying to do is kind of phasing a few people at the moment. And I think they're having to revisit a lot of the architectural concepts to fit everything in. So it might take a little bit longer. Certainly, I would think between 23 and 25, we'll be down there.
And just coming back on partnerships, one that intrigued me when I saw it announced a few months ago was with Angolan, because I remember you saying in the past, I mean, you'd had your experience with Sri Lankan or Air Lanka, and it was more or less never again. It took a lot of time and management. So I was surprised to see that one announced.
Well, the Angolan deal was significantly different to the Sri Lankan one. One, it involved no equity.
Right.
It was basically the Angolan government approaching us and saying, look, we need some help. Can you sort out our aviation sector? Can you sort out our airline? And we decided that, okay, we'd help out. We didn't inject any money. We will not inject any money. We have already prepared the business plan now for the new Angolan airline. That is due for presentation to the government in Angola on Monday. If they buy into it, if they are accepted, then we will execute that through a management team that we'll select and drive it through. But that's the limit of our involvement. It's not an equity stake.
But it would be a new airline, but they would fund that. You would just recommend management.
If they adhere to our business plan and follow that, then we're quite happy to execute it for them.
Now, Tim, one that's much more dear to your heart than some of the things that are maybe occupying your time, fleet. And you were in London a couple of weeks ago to announce that the next batch of 58-380s will be Rolls-Royce powered. There's an ongoing dialogue. I'm sure you have speed dial on the number to Toulouse, to Fabrice Brugier or Tom Enders about improving the A380. And Airbus, publicly at least, seem relatively reticent about that. They've announced that they celebrated, of course, 10 years since the aircraft first flew last week, less than that in service. But do you think you see any signs of traction? They're beginning to believe your vision of a future that it's not only you who could come in and buy a substantially larger number, but other airlines might do it.
I think they are certainly on message. They are believers in this aeroplane. And simpler, the linear extrapolation of growth of what we have today, 3.3 million going to 6.6 in the next 15 years, with airport capacity not growing at the same rate, either in Europe, in Asia, or in North America, you simply have to upgauge your airplane. That, therefore, the 380 is a neat fit. So they don't have a problem with that. Their problem is that other CEOs don't quite see it that way. And I don't want to be disingenuous to my peer group of competitor airlines, but they are a tad risk averse compared to us. And the notion that you can get through 10 or 15 of these 380s through an executive, non-executive board, under the sort of conditions that the global economy has gone through over the last 6 or 7 years, it's not surprising that they are more risk averse than perhaps we are. So they have to, in Toulouse, get over that and persuade people that this is an aircraft for 2021, 2022, and that it will take their city pair growth on the primary hubs, Asia, Europe, North America, and allow them to do that in restricted hubs. Look at Heathrow. If they do not build the third runway, and maybe on Thursday a new British government will come along and definitely say, this isn't going to happen. If Willie forecasts, if his forecasts are right, there will be no third runway at Heathrow. What are you going to do? How are you going to deal with the demand? If you want to fly from Japan or China into Heathrow and you've got one slot, surely you would be putting a 500-seater into it. Okay, so these are the kind of arguments that would, they would hopefully assemble and present to the potential client base. Of course, the upgrade of the 380, which is we're very interested in, much cheaper to run, environmentally friendly, fuel burn, lighter, etc. We're very keen to develop that. But they've got to get past the first hurdle of persuading people to buy it in the first place.
Because what in essence will that give you? It's going to give you those improved fuel economics. It will give you more passenger capacity and range. Would it give an improvement on freight?
It will give us about a 10 to 13%, I hope, reduction in the operating costs of the aircraft, which are already very good.
Yes. And
there is a perception that the aircraft is not a very economic aircraft to fly. It really is. The system seat factor on our 380s of the 60 we have flying last year was 82.5%. It is almost double the profitability per seat kilometer than the other fleet. It is such a good aeroplane. You, of course, have to fill it. But you wouldn't deploy it if you couldn't. That's the point. So, yes, we're pushing very hard to try and get this aircraft done. It'll give us more range, or you can trade that for payload or whatever, which a better aeroplane altogether.
And the other side of the coin, you spoke to Boeing for a number of years. I mean, you were a fan and possibly the fundamental customer behind the emergence of the 777-300 ER, and now having impact on the next generation, the 777X. Again, I heard you on the flight coming over, quite obviously enthusiastic about a new version of this aircraft coming along. And I think I read Boeing has said this is going to be the most economic aircraft in unit seat costs available once it's in service. What will that do for you? Will it simply replace the 777s as they are now? Will it open up new market possibilities and growth as well?
We will replace all our 777s with those aeroplanes. It comes in two variants, the 9X, which is the much bigger one. It'll be able to do 14 or 15-hour missions that we currently do with the 777s. The 8X is the real sweetheart because it'll fly to the other side of the planet with a very good payload. It's a fantastic machine. And Boeing, absolutely right. They have, you're right, we did get involved right in the early days, persuading them, nudging them to take the 777-300ER on. They had terrible time with the 787, so they didn't really have the appetite to get involved, but eventually they came to the market, and they have designed a superb aeroplane. Boeing have been are brilliant aeronautical engineers and designers. Providing propulsion comes along with them, which is what GE have done on this aircraft, we have a real win-win on the aeroplane, both in terms of its range, its speed, its payload, its costs, etc. And I think when this starts flying in late 19 or 20, it'll re-benchmark the way aircraft manufacturers go about designing and so at the same time you've got the 350s coming through.
Well, I was going to ask you about that because, you know, we had the 350 order cancelled, but now you, I think you've said publicly you're talking to Airbus again about the 350 and indeed Boeing about 787. My personal assumption when you cancelled it, I thought, well, maybe it's not big enough for Emirates, given the firepower of the hub, the massive density of connection as well as capacity, you just didn't need it. But it's back on the agenda, so could you just explain a bit
more?
Well,
it's back on the agenda. One primary reason, we wanted to look at it in the light of what the aircraft was actually doing. Mm-hmm. Now it's flying, because there was a gap between our contracted specification
right.
and what was actually okay. on offer. So we wanted to, rather than argue the toss about the bridge of the clauses and the covenants, etc., let's start again. Now, at the same time, Boeing produced the 787-10. And the 787-10 was an aircraft that we were very interested right at the beginning of the 787 program, even when they launched it. Now it's on the market, so we're looking at the 787-10 against 350-900 to see which is going to do the job for us. How many we will buy, when we will buy, we'll let you know.
Right, Tim, we better allow the audience a couple of questions as time is racing along.
It's Rory Jones from the Wall Street Journal.
Hello, Rory.
Hi, Tim. I think that you have directed your pilots recently to fly at something called a cost index 400, which means that your planes are flying at a higher speed and you're disregarding costs to some degree. Why is that, and is that a result of the fuel price?
No. What we asked our pilots to do was adjust the speed at which they flew the aeroplane to the dynamic of that particular moment. In other words, if we've got late runners, we ask them to speed the aircraft up. Let me give you an example. If you're flying a 380 from Dubai to Heathrow and you're late out of the hub by about 20 or 30 minutes, we ask them to speed the aircraft up, providing there was fuel available to do it, so that we would recapture the arrival time at Heathrow. Because we are slot constrained, we have to turn the aircraft within the prescribed time, otherwise we get ourselves into trouble with the UK authorities. Secondly, to get it back on time to feed all the passengers into our hub, then to feed onto multiple connections was why we did. We just asked them to look at it. Now, I think this was asked of them 10 years ago. It's just been a restatement of the way we want to try and make sure that if we have late runners, that we manage to recapture the block time and timelines.
We've had another question over here somewhere. There's two, in fact. This lady first and the gentleman behind second.
Ben Flanagan from Al Arabiya. So Tim, you, obviously we're talking about the open skies spat with your US rivals. I wondered, you know, is Emirates considering any court action for defamation or damages against the big three in the US? And if so, are you in the process of drawing up any documentation as to any damages to either your reputation or top line that could form the basis of such a claim in the courts?
Our focus at the moment is responding to the document that's been put in front of us. We are aware that there may be issues that could be damaging to us, both commercially in terms of income production or brand, and we will look at those and see where they sit in the overall picture of the rebuttal. That's as far as I'm prepared to go at this point in time. At the moment, as I said, our focus is response, and we will do that first.
Okay, the lady in front. I'm going to go to the next question because the time's just a bit tight.
Sarah Townsend from Arabian Business Magazine. Apparently, Iran has put its prices up by as much as four times flying over its airspace because of security issues. Do you know about that, and has it had an impact, and what are the political implications, if so?
Answer, no. I don't. We have a number of alternatives that we can fly over Saudi Arabia or we could fly over Iran. But of that, I'm not immediately aware that there has been a change.
Any more questions? There's a couple down here. There's a lady down here.
him, Gemma Greenwood. I just wondered what you'll do if the A380 is not upgraded or worse, discontinued, given your model is very much based on that aircraft.
Well, we will go to our friends in Boeing and Airbus and say, well, okay, they're not on the market anymore. We will try and work them for as long as we can, and as we will expect Airbus to support them as long as we need them to be supported. But in the end, we will have to adjust our business model to what is available at the time. It is a real pity, because as John said, today we have five A380s going into Heathrow, 517 seats in, 517 seats out. If we have to go down to a 777-9X, which is a great aeroplane, I will lose a minimum of 100, 120, 130 seats. What's the point? But in the end, we have to cut our cloth. Emirates is not going to stop because the 380 isn't there for them. And as long as, well, I know it'll be here well after I'm not here. And it'll still be flying. The future management team will decide how to refleet the organization, but Emirates will be Emirates.
Good afternoon, Tim. Thank you for an enlightening discussion. I'm Jasmine. I actually work for Emirates. I have a question about something that you had stated in a previous interview, which is that after the transatlantic connection, the next challenge is the trans-Pacific one. How has this fracas with the big three impacted that ambition?
Well, if Emirates wishes to operate on the trans-Pacific geographical area, we will do that. There is nothing in the air services agreement with the United States that precludes us from doing that. There are certain countries in Asia which have open skies agreements with the United Arab Emirates, and those are obviously the ones that we would look at with regard to mounting operations across the Pacific. So yes, I have said in the past we have looked at transpac operations. Yes, there are a number of cities that we could serve on the Pacific Rim as well as in the US. And I see no reason why at this point in time that we shouldn't continue our studies as to when and where that should take place.
Just one more question, yeah.
Dina Kamel from Bloomberg. I'm just wondering if you can give us any idea on whether you've heard any more from Airbus and when they could make a decision on the A380neo, and whether you've given them a deadline to work towards it for that upgrade.
I haven't heard anything more from Airbus about what their deliberations may or may not be. Two, we have not given them a deadline. We're not in the business of setting deadlines to third parties. We have just imparted to them our belief that there is a future of this aeroplane, that we will buy more of these aeroplanes if they produce them over the timeline that we have set. So we're just waiting. Maybe June, July, August, we'll see.
Tim, I just want to comment two more myself. Just a quick word on safety. We've had a challenging year with things unusual in terms of safety in the industry, and I'm thinking, of course, the MH17 tragedy and the recent Germanwings tragedy. You certainly commented in the period post MH17 about learnings, not least in communication and sharing information. What is your feeling about either of these events? I mean, they're both quite extraordinary. Perhaps we haven't really seen things like this before, and now we have issues about training and mental health and this type of thing. Is there a way the industry can ever get a handle on every safety issue, or is it something we can learn from these recent experiences?
Well, I mean, the aviation safety is driven by events and incidents mm-hmm. and accidents. So what's happened in the last year, or that's 18 months with regard to 17370, the AirAsia in off Borneo, and more recently the German Wings, we will constantly learn, and of course Air France a few years ago. These were all events that were shocking to the business. New events, shooting down Malaysian 17, the loss of 370, which today still hasn't been found, the German Wings incident, the Air France incident. So the industry will reel and come back and sort itself out. So you see the initial reactions to the Eurowings, doors closed, cabin crew on flight deck, never two together, etc. Malaysian 17 created a sea change in thought with regard to the how we go about assessing the security situation on the ground and how we must work together with government agencies and also amongst ourselves as the industry to ensure we're safe. So, you know, as tragic as it has been and devastating as it has been, you can never stop learning. And those that believe that we know it all and we will never be faced with a situation that we could say was preventable are wrong. And unfortunately, but we arm ourselves with history. Mm-hmm. We arm ourselves with our response to those accidents, and we arm ourselves with the changes to the business, whether it be the macro level in terms of the safety cultures that permeate through the industry itself and the airlines. As you know, I sit on top of the safety group of the airline. We meet regularly. It covers every facet of operation, and I will drive a safety system and understanding in the DNA of what we do. That's something that the airline industry has always done. But will we continue to learn? Yes, we will continue to learn, and hopefully be better people for it.
And Tim, my last question, with time available. I mean, this is 30 years this year. I don't know when the date is, but it was 85, wasn't it, when Emirates began? You were there from the beginning. Can you encapsulate 30 years in a few seconds? I mean, asking you the impossible. I mean, wherever Emirates has come from,
I don't know where it's all
today.
Gone. I don't know where it's all gone. I was quite young when I came.
Button.
And I look in the mirror now, I get a big shock and think, what happened? But I look back at the 90s and I look back at the formative years and I look back at 2000, and so many things have happened within the airline. I mean, look what happened to Dubai. When I first came to Dubai, and what it is today. I mean, that in itself is probably the most profound thing in the airline's history and existence, is this
the
place.
The link with Dubai.
Unbelievable. I've never seen a city of any kind of entity like this come out of nothing to what it is today. So, you know, that has shaped, it has driven, it has affected everything that we have done. And I guess if Dubai had been like it was in 1985, or when I first came here in 1975, what would the airline look like? It wouldn't be as big. It would have a business model that was not dissimilar to what we have today, but the element of local business would be far, far smaller. You know, the way we're going to look at this show, and look at the people are coming from all over the world to get to this show. What will happen with Expo 2020 when we bring in 17 million people in a 6-month period to come here? That's all about what this place is. And it's underpinned our business model. It's underpinned everything we've done. So when I look back and I think, my God, where did that come from? I still drive down the Sheikh Zayed Road twice a day looking at the Burj Khalifa and said, this is the most spectacular thing I have ever seen in my life. And I remain in awe of what goes on and what's to come. So long may it last. Long may these guys be as visionary and as their business acumen excels all other cities in the world. And people look at Dubai and they say, what is it that they have that we can't do or we haven't got? I talked to Boris Johnson, who's the mayor of London, and he prides himself on London, right, he should do. Bigger, fastest growing city inbound for tourism. But he came to Dubai and he sat on the roof of our head office building. He goes round the Burj Khalifa and Boris's eyes were out on storks and he waxes lyrical in the political landscape of the United Kingdom about what Dubai has done. And what a pity it is that the United Kingdom political chattering classes can't do what Dubai has done. So in terms of when I look back, I think if there's one thing that comes is a shining light in everything that we've done, it's been what's happened here.
Well, I mean, even I remember coming myself in about 87, working for British Caledonian, who of course you worked for. Dubai for us was really a technical stop on the way to Hong Kong, but we got about 30 people every day. Emirates began, and I remember thinking, how on earth can Dubai warrant setting up an airline and flying an A310 to Gatwick? I mean, I flew on it with my staff ticket, and I was somewhat hooked because it was better than British Caledonian service, and I've watched it since that time. So Tim, I personally could, if you had the time, lock you into a seat and keep on asking you questions for another hour or two, but I know you've got to go with a busy agenda. So thank you very much for your time today. We look forward to having you back again in the future. An early happy birthday to the company, an interesting 30 years. And yep. Thank you very much to Tim. Ladies and gentlemen, Sir Tim Clark, President of Emirates.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks, John.